Hi guys. Well, I finally get some time to myself. So it's just you and me. Cheers. So what's this video all about? Well, it's going to be a very awkward video because I'm packing quite a lot of stuff into a very, very small timescale. The nub of it is that there was a program called Why We Voted to Leave, Britain Speaks. The tagline to it is this: Adrian Childs goes home to the West Midlands to meet Leave voters from both sides of the political divide and find out why Britain voted for Brexit. It was first broadcast in July 2016. Ideally, I'd want to leave this a couple of years before doing this kind of video, but I'm doing it now because, where are we? We're coming up to the end of March 2017, and if I do it now, then at least there's about another 2 months on the clock for you to be able to watch the programme itself on iPlayer. I'm going to film a reaction video and discussion and various points while I'm watching it and listening to it. But obviously it's from the BBC and, you know, fair use doesn't really apply to the UK, or if it does, it's potentially sketchy, so I can't actually show you that. But in order to get over this, it's necessary to do some groundwork and also reach a few understandings. You know, a chunk of this is generalization, because even in the TV show itself, there was an awful lot of detail left missing, an awful lot of questions that I believe that Childs could have asked and didn't. But I think it's important, as you guys know, I voted Remain, but I was very sceptical about the progress of the EU political side of things, and I certainly believe that change needs to happen there in order for the EU to progress. Otherwise, I think more countries are going to ultimately go the way of the UK. But this programme made an impact on me because it was from the people who actually voted, as opposed to all of that campaign crap and the lies that we were getting from both sides of the fence. Leave wasn't the only ones who were cooking the books. Remain was also. And at the end of the day, we all voted for a reason. And it was an important step for me to understand why some of these people voted the way they did. And that's one of the things that I want to look at. And indeed, there was a question asked at the end of the program, which is the question that's going to be answered throughout the next few years. We don't have all the questions yet. Well, we don't have all the answers yet. Indeed, I think we don't have all the questions yet, to be perfectly honest, as will become clear through a few other bits and pieces, because I've watched the program a few times. I am somewhat familiar with the order of things. But there's a few things that I wanted to make clear and do the groundwork before starting on this. You'll find some links in the hoo-ha bar. The first link is to the iPlayer program itself. There should be at least 2 months left on the clock for you to be able to view it for yourself. The second is a group of three links. Now, I know that the long story short is this is not about people. This is not about religion. This is not about communities. This is about economics and politics. Those three links take you to people who also fought alongside Britain and for the whole effort in the Second World War. Polish squadrons flew Spitfires. You have people, Muslim religions and others. The, you know, this this is not aimed at any particular group of people. At the heart of this is economics and politics. And us people, no matter where we're from, no matter where we hail from, no matter what religion we are, we, at the end of the day, are the ones suffering down to this. And I know a chunk of this myself because I've worked elsewhere in Europe, and I've had the slimmest of flavours, just in 2 years, of the economics of being from one country, working in another, paying tax and sending money back home. And I've sort of had this from the reverse angle. And, This is not about blame. There's plenty of blame to go around. I mean, it all depends on where you draw the line yourself. And this is not about that. This is about understanding motivations and politics and how this whole damn thing came to be. Now there's a third group of links. And those are to a number of things. Where have we got here? No. Because there's a few things that we need to get clear. The first one is the economic side. Translation directory articles, which is translation of average monthly wage in different European countries. When Europe started, it was just a handful of countries, which were sort of reasonably even-ish on wages, or at least wages as per expense. Now, as the European community has grown and taken in more countries, it's taken in more countries for whom that balance is quite different. And that has its effect on the freedom of movement and the ability of people to move and gain employment in other areas. When I was working in the Netherlands, Germany, etc., the economics were different. At home in the UK, our housing was relatively cheaper and our taxes were relatively cheaper compared to some of the other countries that I was working in. But the cost of, say, going out for a meal and the quality of life was quite a bit higher in the UK. In the EU, I could afford to go out more often and socialise better and even have a better quality of life to some degree. More on that in a bit. But for people from other countries, it's, you know, that balance is completely different. What they can buy in the originating country for what they earn in one of the other balanced countries, you know what I mean. There's quite a marked difference there. And that's pretty much one of the economic pressures which caused? Well, we see it on a macro level in the UK itself. You know, I mean, how many of us, for example, the difference between north and south, you know, a property here will cost twice as much as it would up north. And people come down south to earn more because of the wage difference and within the country. This is the same pressure, but on an international scale, on an EU-wide scale. That's pretty much what's going on here. And that's one of the things you'll see. But there were a few other things in the mix. The Working Time Directive of 2003. It basically stipulated the amount of hours that people were expected to work. And on top of that, workers in other countries generally had greater rights, and you'll find a few other odds and sods on top of that. Like the firm that starts work at 9:06 a.m. Workers in many of the EU countries have better rights than we do in the UK. Here we had, historically, the unions were strong in the UK until the Thatcher era, and pretty much the unions were broken. And the balance of power then turned to commercial interests, the businesses. They are, as you know from my politics, I view the commercial entities as pretty much one of the major villains of the piece. Also in the US, and the drive against social, you have socialism, and you have commercialism, for want of better terms. When you look at places like China, Russia, and places like America, and what the UK has become, which have gone to the extremes, it's not working. It's just not working. Any reasonable society has a balance of both. And I believe that's what the majority of the founding European nations actually managed to achieve. To a degree, I mean, there's problems, but I believe that their foundation on that balance was more sound than the UK. In the UK, commercial interests have pretty much reigned. When it came to the European Working Directive, what the UK managed to win for us was an exemption. That exemption, where is it? After the 1993 council negotiations, when the directive was agreed to, after an 11-1 vote, UK Employment Secretary David Hunt said, "It is a flagrant abuse of community rules. It has been brought forward as such simply to allow majority voting, a ploy to smuggle through part of the social chapter by the back door. The UK strongly opposes any attempt to tell people they can no longer work the hours they want." That, I think, was the one of the undoings of the UK, handing more power to the commercial side to further enslave the worker. All you've got to do is tick the box that says I agree to the exemption. And how many of us on taking a job actually have the balls to not tick that box? Pretty much it would guarantee that we're at the door, unofficially. And this is having an effect on us. Overwork. There are a number of articles. If you wish to find anything pretty much on the work-life balance, and indeed there are now some companies who are actually paying their staff to get a good night's sleep. You know, one of the things that these fitness trackers that people are wearing is if they can turn in their fitness tracker data that shows they had a good restful sleep and, you know, looked after their own health, then they pretty much get a bonus from the employers. If I can find that one, I'll add it to the link, to the list link. But here we go. This is from September 2016. Ill health or disability is forcing 1 in 8 people to stop working before they reach the state pension age, the TUC says. It found almost 500,000 people have had to leave work for medical reasons within 5 years before they were due to retire. In March, the government announced an independent review into the state pension age. The government said it already provides support for ill or disabled workers. Research by the TUC, however, points to a significant north-south divide. In the southwest of England, just 1 in 13 people blamed sickness or disability for leaving work. However, that figure rises to 1 in 7 in the north of England, Scotland and Wales, and 1 in 4 in Northern Ireland. Those in the lowest paid jobs or in manual work are also twice as likely to stop working for health reasons than managers or professionals. There's more to that, and that north-south divide plays in. When you look at the leave statistics, people in the north of England pretty much overwhelmingly were leave. And that's one of the things that is addressed when you need to keep in mind when we look at this this program, because that was that's where he goes. That's where Adrian Charles goes to talk with people. Yeah. It's pretty telling. And the long story short, the first person that we're going to trip across in the report is someone who started off as a soldier, became a steel worker. This is his story, and like I said at the very top of this, there's a lot of detail missing. He started off in the steel work and over a number of years learnt and worked his way up the trade. Then what he says is that skilled workers came in from other countries, undercut him and pretty much put him out of a job. One of the obvious things that happened, I mean, I'll also see if I can find a link now to add in. Where are we? Oh, redundancy, that was the word. I'm going to have to find the links to this, which is change to employment conditions. People have been told, and this is in the public sector, regardless of unionisation, which is an indication of how weak the unions are now, to sign new contracts of employment which are less favourable than the previous ones, or effectively, you're redundant. So, it's a case of either take the pay cut or goodbye, and we'll hire somebody else to do your job. And that's in this country. That's in the UK. Where is the protection for the workforce? It's just not there anymore. The exact details of this person's case right at the top, we don't know. We know bits and pieces, but there's yet more questions to be answered. But that is one of the principal reasons and threads that comes through. As a number of, one of the other common threads is that people, even people who voted Leave, who were in this documentary, recognised the need for migration, that it was a necessary part of any society that migration happens, because there are skills shortages and blips that have to be smoothed out. But one of the bones of contention is now it is too much. Now people are losing their jobs. And that is one of the other things. So, I'm going to reset this and I'll be back with you in just a moment. Okay, here we go. Credits are rolling. This is 10 days after the Hall vote happened. It Adrian Charles is setting the scene for the hall vote. What happened? The sheer segregation and this is Panorama going in and talking with the people. Their hopes for the future and roughly what's going on. And ask why they chose leave. Panorama credits, still rolling. Ba, 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 ba. Yeah. They're on the screen, live at West Bromwich bus station. And he's doing a radio piece. Okay, that's still part of the intro. They're just setting the scene. He's saying that he was born and raised in the West Midlands and he's gone back to understand because he now lives in London. So he's going back to understand that this is what he's laying down. He's not accepting various things that people say, all this thing. He knows the people where he's come from. Are reasonable people, so he's gone back to understand. They're now with the first person at Tiverton Estate. The person's been there all his life, born there. Jobs are thin on the ground. This is the first person I said. John Butler, ex-soldier. He's taking Adrian through where he used to live. And bits and pieces he's renting now. They've got six kids and they rent a 3-bedroom house. Been a soldier, steel worker, as I think I mentioned at the full start of this, out of work, says the job centre isn't any help. They're saying here's a £200 a week job, but what good is that when the rent is over £600 a month? £800 a month minus £600 plus rent, then council tax. There's nothing left over, so what the heck is the point of that kind of job? Where does money for food and the rest of it come off top of that? The £14 an hour job in the steel industry came to an end when people came in and started doing the job for less than half that. How he'd worked his way up and all the rest of that. Undercutting is the long story short on this, is what he's saying. And that they want jobs back. Enough is enough. John's pinning a lot of his hopes on the Leave vote to make this happen. Right, this is the interesting thing. He wants his kids, he doesn't want his kids to be working in the factory. He wants his kids to be going for a higher education and getting better jobs than he did, like any other parent wanting better for their own children. And he hopes that voting leave will help for that. He knows that it's going to take time. I'm pausing here. Okay, it's a fair chunk to take in, but what he's saying is that he wants better for his kids, like any parent. But with other people coming in and undercutting, it's impossible for people to actually make that foundation and build that foundation from which the next generation can springboard. That's pretty much what he's saying. Some of the short, some of the bits that are short on detail is how this happened, and this is where I think some of the employer issue and the lack of worker rights has come in here. There is no protection for a worker that that protects that worker from just being made redundant and somebody else brought in to do the same job at a cheaper rate. That's where I think that the employer has a serious amount to answer. You know, yes, there are those that will answer that, hey, this is commercial pressures for you. This is the whole thing on which competition is born. Yeah, try telling that to him. This argument will come on later. He's now in a marketplace, West Bromwich Market, and he's talking with people, and there are people here of all nationalities, and the majority of them are voted out. There are people here from all sort of ethnic backgrounds, you know, and about 60-odd% of them voted Leave. From what he's asking people how they voted, it's a heavy immigrant population that's made up this area. And he's talking now with one particular person. Grandparents came from India in the 50s, owns a burger van, his own business, Kuli Grewal. He's saying about his birth and upbringing. They were brought up on British food, British culture, despite the ethnicity of the appearance. You know, they do British things, go to Dudley Zoo, all the usual bits. And he's saying that there's a difference between his parents' immigration and that immigration era and the current immigration era. That his parents came to be part of the country to better themselves, and that the new immigrants are financial immigrants, that they don't want to become part of the community. That's what this guy is saying. And he is also laying the blame squarely at the door of EU migrants, is what he's saying. Contracts ended, not renewed. And he is feeling, as well as like the person below, when he was facing homelessness, these guys would just come in with nothing from another country. Okay. Adrian is saying now, pardon me, I've just paused it again, and that everyone that he's spoken to has laid, early in the conversation, has said levels of immigration, very early on in the conversation. As the previous person was saying, is that he was, when contracts were coming to an end, they weren't being renewed because somebody else was coming in from elsewhere in Eastern Europe and basically undercutting him. So his business went down the tubes. And when he was facing homelessness, he felt that other people who had come to the country with nothing were actually jumping ahead in the queue for housing. That's what he's saying. Now, there was separate research elsewhere as to whether that was an impression that people were getting and whether that was actually factually what was happening on the ground. I'm going to have to see if I can dig that out. And that is an avenue worth exploring. But that is something which is repeatedly comes up and has come up whenever this kind of subject has hit throughout history, I think, throughout the last 100 years, whenever there has been a fresh wave come in to settle in the UK, there's always been this this thing. I'm thinking that there was a historic thing when even people from other, you know, it's not just now. It's happened previously in our history, and I'm going to have to try and look that up. I'm just going to make a note to myself. Look up early generation impression of immigrants getting preferential treatment. That's one thing I'm going to have to look up. There's going to be, at the moment, we've got the initial link in one group on its own to this program that I'm watching now. We then have a small group of 3 links, and then we have another group of 5 links. And now I'm going to have to build up another group of links to deal with what we're dealing with now. Democracy. Many leavers feel as if they've had a meaningful vote from the first time. He's now visiting another person, Katie Oliver, who moved to the area from Wiltshire. Now, she is also having extra problems because she's just had a flood. She's also in permanently ill health. And she had a stillborn son early on, so she's in currently on disability benefits, and she's really had a, yeah. What they've said here is that she's had a serious string of bad luck. For the first time, she feels engaged in politics, and that her vote now in this Leave vote actually counted for something. But one of the things that Adrian has put to her is, why didn't she vote in the previous elections? Why did she wait until now to actually vote? You've had democratic control all your life in this country, but yet you haven't voted in an election. You're passionate about democracy, but you haven't voted in general elections. She says, well, that's changing. Yeah. I'm going to pause here. It does seem that a number of people have just bungled along in politics, and the last couple of years, these major shake-ups have been what has woken people up to politics, and the old saying that just because you don't take an interest in politics doesn't mean the politics doesn't take an interest in you. It's been a divisive period, but I think it's been very much a positive period in that more people, I hope, will get engaged in politics and will actually exercise their right to vote. As I've said on this channel on numerous occasions, Vote. Do it. Whatever. I don't care. Whatever you vote for, just vote. I've said it before and I'll continue to say it again, and many others say it again. And I think that if anything, Brexit here and what's happened in the US recently has probably re-energized people in politics, whereas previously we maybe had it so smooth, relatively speaking, and so much relative peace that we've just let politics slide because our lives are busy enough as it is without trying to keep track of politics as well. And I think that is changing. One of the things that she is saying and is about to say, well, she's currently saying about how the racists have their views have rubbed off on the people who have genuine feelings and voted Leave for their reasons. It makes it look as if it's painted all Leave voters as being racist, which she's saying isn't the case. And she is one of the people who actually said that, you know, migration is a necessary thing, is a necessary part of society. I'm just going to unpause. Immigration is what makes the world go round. It's not a bad thing, it's a good thing. That's quoting her now. So what's the issue then? I feel like this country is falling apart. I voted Leave because I don't feel like the government are putting enough back into the community, into our councils. The housing situation, feel like we're helping everybody else, yet we're forgetting here. I've paused it, as you can probably obviously tell. Now, I do know that sending money abroad to help other communities, other countries, other people in need is, to a degree, it's part of diplomacy and sort of opens doors to other things, to other trade deals and bits and pieces that come after. But it's at another level. For example, I mean, we can have a charity drive. We're having another one now. If you remember Band-Aid back in the 90s, was it? The late 80s, early 90s? I think it was the 90s. The British people put a phenomenal amount of money, but they put their hands in their pockets to help. There is now another drive now for another crisis that's happening in Africa. And it looks like the numbers being donated are again phenomenal. And it doesn't seem to be the generosity of the British people that's in question. It's how it gets there through our tax money. And I do think that there's another side of this which needs further investigation, in which what Britain is getting back in terms of further deals and reputation and other things that aren't exactly easily visible, if you know what I mean. You know, a good degree of our food and other things, the exotic things that we like to eat, believe it or not, bananas and other things like that, come from other countries. You know, and competition in the world is getting greater. So it's part of playing the international political game. You know, it's, again, it's not as straightforward that can be covered here. But I feel that the position that we're in now and her complaint that the government isn't putting in enough money when you look at the government incomes and tax and what's happening, that is one area where I believe that, again, commercial interests, and particularly the big guys who are not paying their fair share of tax, are denying government the funds to do what needs to be done socially. That is where I believe the big hole is. And that is where I believe the hole needs to be plugged, and that more multinational enterprise who are in the position to be able to juggle funds between different countries and play by different tax rules, they are the ones, they are the weak link in the chain. They are able to pay tax at the rate that they prefer in the country in which they prefer it. And as a result, other countries are being starved of that tax income. And that tax income, which we are talking significant amounts of money, is what's needed to keep this country running socially, to provide the funds that we need for our schoolings, our hospitals, our roads, our infrastructure, our society. Okay, we hit orange. And here we are again. Unpause. Okay, he's now going to some of the Remainers who are in despair for all the opportunities that are being lost. While he's talking with them, I'm going to revisit some of the other stuff as to what's going to happen with regards the jobs front and the people who are undercutting. A degree of that will depend on what is negotiated. And this is, I think, going to be one of the key issues. Oh, pardon me. Lots of Britons have emigrated to other countries, to other EU countries. And if Britain says, no, these people in this country who have undercut our people have to go back to their countries, then we can be pretty sure that the EU will retaliate and say, okay, have your own people back. That'll cause a lot of grief. Whereas if they say, okay, the people already here can stay here, then that is not going to change anything for the people who have had their jobs taken from them. Nothing is going to change for those people. Personally, I think it's going to be the latter situation. I can't see our government wishing to upset all the people who have had enough money in order to be able to move abroad and have a nice life somewhere else. They are, yeah, it's changing to a business right now. We're switching to a businessman. Peter Shirley, owner of Midland Food Group, set up in 76 and grown. He has 230 workers. That's an important figure. He's seen and reaped the benefits of the single market, but he voted leave. He thinks everything's going to be fine when we're out, and he won't risk the red tape. He's saying unrealistic regulations. As an example, the directive saying that we've got to assess the amount of packaging that would be used in a year. An estimate. He He's saying if you could guess that, then you're a magician. Now, there are a few regulations that have come in from Europe, and it's not quite as clear-cut. For a start, even when I was working in Germany at the turn of the century, the attitude towards recycling was very different to Britain at the time, and we're still on catch-up, basically. Even when I was living where I was living, there was recycling even for organic waste. So the food that I didn't eat had its own particular area that it went into, which, yes, was pretty much covered with flies at the time. But, recycling was a different matter. And what I believe here is an investigation into packaging, wasteful packaging. The amount can be recycled. But, again, this is a complex issue that is being brought down into just a few seconds of TV time. And the way he's putting it here, I think that there's been not adequate explanation given to him as to why this is needed and what is going to come of it. If I was to hazard a guess, I would hazard the guess that those kinds of figures would play into legislation on packaging and how much of it must be recycled, etc., etc., recyclable, etc. I think that a lot has been lost in translation between parties. A lot of these directives have come down and people haven't just even understood them or understood the purpose behind them. You know, they've needed more. People need more than just do this. They need to be motivated to do this, to understand what the benefits will be. On top of that, Britain hasn't helped with what a practice known as gold plating, which is taking the regulation and actually going further and adding further levels to it. And actually, the banana legislation was another case in point. If you actually look up the documentation on that, that was a simple classification issue. It's a case of if you go and buy a particular item, then you get to choose between, you'll know that a grade A of an item is going to be to a certain standard. If you're willing to go to a grade B, then the standard is going to be less, but you expect to pay less. That was pretty much the issue with the banana thing. It was a classification. A banana has to be within certain parameters to be considered a class A banana. Otherwise, it was a class B banana. And you would expect, you know, that was what was behind that. That wasn't a... And it was seized on and really played to death by not only the Leave campaign, but other anti-EU people before it. Oh, the EU is telling us what a banana must be. No, it was a consumer aid. So that in order for a retailer to claim that a banana was class A, the highest quality that was worth the money you were paying for it, then it had to be within certain restrictions. Otherwise, no, class B. And, you know, that was a classic one that was, do some reading up on that. What's the point of having information that's totally useless? That was the practicality of the European Union show to a T. He didn't understand. Nobody told him what was the purpose here. Now they're travelling around the factory and doing bits and pieces and understanding the product that's being made. He sees flaws in the whole EU project. He says it was a common market, now it's a political union. He's a graduate of Cambridge, studied history, the political empires of the European Union don't last. Far too many different countries. Which is a fair point, and that is, to a degree, what has happened and will continue to happen to the EU, even without the UK. He switched to the immigration issue and the load on public services. A tenth of his Polish staff are Polish. He says they're great. They come over here, they've got a car, they've got a flat, they're having children, they're part of our society, and they're okay, there's nothing wrong with them at all. So, but it's just that our services have not been built up to cope with that. It's no use taking in again, you're coming back to the issue of so many people coming in, not able to get doctor's appointments, school children places. The infrastructure hasn't been expanded to take the people that are coming in. That, to me, comes back to, okay, where's the money coming from? That is coming, to me, back to taxes, and is coming back to corporates. Peter is saying we should take this opportunity now to stand back and take a look at the kind of society that we've got. We should be one nation, work together, but I happen to feel that that one nation is Great Britain. I don't feel that it's part of the European Union. That's what he's just said. Yeah. What is Great Britain? I've asked that question of a number of people over the last year or so that I happen to have talked with over the whole issue, and in some cases people can't really answer that. It's a feeling rather than anything that people can actually put into written words and write down what Britain is. I think that people are, rather than working from what nation we are, we only know enough to know what nation we don't want to be. And anything which we see as pushing us in those directions is what we're actually rebelling against. If that makes any sense. He's switching again. A pub, the Wonder, the pub landlord. Tiverdale near Dudley. Brian Morris is that man, the pub landlord. Apart from an England goal, is there anything else I can get you? And immigration levels again were a big concern. If you can't get your child into a school, that will have an effect. politicians' rhetoric going down badly in those parts, because as you said, if you've got a house which is big enough for your needs, you're living in a nice leafy suburb, your life is nice and sorted, then where is your reason to actually want change? It's the people who have seen what's so far been delivered, and they need change, that have pretty much voted for Leave. That's the nuts and bolts of what this is coming down to. It was more or less a two fingers up at the establishment. Adrian is saying that even here he's getting the sense that whatever, if there's one thing that the referendum has done, it's re-engaged people in politics. And in my view, that's a good thing. That's a brilliant thing. Superb. Thursday morning, my phone was going off. What should I do? Where should I be voting? And the general questions. Jim Ferry says, I want my country back. Originally from the northeast, lived in Irvington, North Birmingham for years. Once being British was an identity. I come from Erdington. Now it's like little Poland. Nothing against Poles, nothing against any of the Eastern Europeans. Here purely for money, not here for the social aspects of life. Don't contribute towards the community spirit and just breaking the community apart. Politicians totally out of touch. Now, I don't agree with him totally on that. Britain itself is changing. Continues to change, and there's another person that will make another point else later on in this. We have been changing, our society has been changing on top of all this. In not so long ago, you know, children would follow their parents into their vocations and live within the same communities. People would know each other and know each other's history. And recently, within the last few decades, if not a bit more, I think, we've had to move away as things have changed, as industry that was previously considered to be the backbone of a particular area, such as coal mining, such as steel manufacture, such as whatever it happens to be, has basically broken down. The world has moved on. And our societies, you know, the local societies are much different now. It's, I could live here where I do and know literally only the few people. I know my next door neighbours that way quite well. We talk on a reasonably frequent basis. Get on well. Neighbour that way, not so much. And it's perhaps, I don't know. I mean, that is one of the other reasons why all this, I decided to visit the pub once a week and get involved with people and sort of plug myself in a bit more. Towards the community spirit. We cannot lay all of the breakdown of our community spirit down to immigration and other people who are not taking part in the community. We can't lay it all at that door. It's far more complicated than that. We've also got the move away from religion. I mean, religion, for what you put at the door of Christianity, it was for quite some time until relatively recently the central pillar of community spirit and community connection. As things have changed, things have split off. People don't believe and don't go to church, whichever denomination, and thus don't meet other people. It's possible for you to just get up, go to work, come back, eat, order a pizza and go to sleep, get up, go to work, and never meet your neighbours. You know? So we cannot lay that purely at the door of immigration, I don't think. Our community cohesion is a problem. But simply stopping immigration is not going to solve that. From the community point of view, he's going on about get the community back, stopping the influx of people who are no more interested in England than just making a few bob. It's all about money. They're going for a coffee to try and chat this out. They're talking about his early community feelings. Sense of all being part of the same thing. Same heritage. Same ideals. Same views. They're talking about, they're being here, buying things, but he just said, how often does the common man appear in front of the camera? You know, they're scared too because of political correctness. The sense of community. People who are here are contributing to the local community monetarily, using services, paying rent, buying food, etc. But he's talking about the sense of community, and as I've just said, the sense of community is more complicated than that. Our country has changed in levels beyond that even if the immigration hadn't happened, we were changing anyway. Things were just changing and will continue to change, as we'll come to the high street with another person when I come back after this orange break. Okay, here we are with yet another refill, and we're carrying on. We've only got about another 7 minutes left of this. He's saying that being English doesn't mean anything anymore. That's... yeah. He's switching to another couple. I think the last couple. Hazel and Barry Priest from Tipton. They're in the park, walking the dogs, talking. Both retired. basically introducing them, what they're doing now. Their newly acquired narrowboat. To them, the area that they've been in has changed beyond all recognition over the years. A lot of the factories have gone. Anything to do with making things has disappeared. He thinks the country can produce. We've got the workforce. We just need the opportunity. And voting out would give us that opportunity. Because we can take control of our own destiny. Whoa, 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 whoa. Ha ha. Whoa, 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 whoa. Okay, voting out would not allow us to take control of our own destiny in that regard. At the very best, we would be producing goods for our own consumption. Our manufacturing has disappeared through global pressures, not just as a result of immigration, and voting out leaving the EU will not change that. In fact, it could make it worse to a degree because it would put us in competition. Now, we have had some industry return, well, not return, but new investment from outside countries that are investing in this country in terms of some car manufacturing plants. There's been a lot of headlines and a lot of questions asked as to what it was that the government gave those companies in order to start up these new lines in the UK. But a lot of this, the industry that was, has gone. And it's not because of immigration, it's because of global pressures. For example, the steel changed. I mean, the influx of cheap steel from China just blew the global steel markets out of the water. And that's going to take political resolutions to that. And also, it's now... I mean, a chunk of it is down to us and what we're buying. A lot of it is down to the common person. I mean, Mary Portis, this is one of the things. She kick-started the lingerie, her Kinky Knickers range, which in the course of which put more than 30-odd people back in employment on this line. Kick-started lace manufacturing in the UK, which had been dead for a number of years. But what did we do? What did we do? We didn't buy them. And because we didn't buy them, all that effort went to waste and the whole damn thing had to go and get folded. You know, for a degree of this, we need, for a degree of our manufacturing, we need to look at ourselves. You know, it's... we are in some cases our own worst enemy, and this is a lot more complicated. And global and local pressures, immigration didn't really cause this. If anything, it would be the immigration workers who would keep the industries running. But yet the factories vanished. Factories didn't vanish because of immigration. Factories vanished because people started buying goods from elsewhere and raw materials from elsewhere. That's why the factories vanished. How has Tipton changed? Remember, little girl, this street here, right hand side of the road, completely full of shops. Completely. Oh, Saturday was like busy. Was a busy, thriving town. Immigration again. squeezing the natural people to the limits with jobs, with housing. Instead of keeping the money in the country, they're sending it back to their own country. Volume. Shops shutting and local degeneration is again, it's one of those oxymorons. How can people come in and take jobs of shops and industries that aren't there anymore? Doesn't make sense. But he's now saying that Hazel had, for him, the clearest view of why the vote went to Leave's way. At the end of the day, that river of all that's wrong has been forced on the rich people by the EU. These bodies can't do that, can't do this. And all that river has flowed into one big, massive sea of anger. Now, what they're saying here is that it's the dribs and drabs over the years of diktat and regulation coming down from the EU that has got people to the point where enough is enough, and they feel that they've been dictated to by Europe. Fair point. But is it real? Now, to a degree, yes. To another degree, it's more complicated than that. This is coming up to another case of, it's not a case that the grass is greener on the other side of the fence. It's that the grass on this side of the fence has become indigestible and inedible, and they just want to move on. Yes, it's going to take time. People seem to accept that. And yes, it is the unknown. People seem to accept that. But going into the unknown is preferable than continuing to eat this grass. And that seems to be where the EU has failed. And it's not only failing the UK, it's failed the other countries in this as well. And it's failed in terms of inclusion, in terms of giving everybody the picture and energizing people to being part of the EU, to putting across the vision and to showing people where these things are leading and where they will be worthwhile. To a degree, one of the things that came on earlier in this is that it is so many different countries now with so many different outlooks on the world and so many different ways of doing things, attempting to do things from different stances of ideology, that Maybe it could never work. At least not in this time. Just listening to the closing words. None of the leavers I spoke to think it will be easy. We don't know what's going to happen, but I very much believe that if we unite, we can make this work. I really do believe that. I really do. I think if anything is going to change the way politics are run, I think it'll probably have a totally radical effect on politics, and that can only be good. The leaders have spoken. And in these uncertain times, only one thing's for sure. They're expecting action. You've invested so much hope in this vote, and many others have. How are you going to feel if, in 3 years' time, if it's all... You'll be furious. We'll all be furious. Whoever voted out will be livid. I'd say, what was my time wasting to be going down to that poll station to go and vote? The people we're spoken to are demanding real change. Which begs two questions. Will they get it? And if they don't, who will they blame? Close of program. Like I said, in a degree of that, there is obviously a lot of simplistic stuff, and a degree of change that we've faced is not only down to immigration, but is down to how our society has changed anyway, and changed so rapidly that we don't really know who to blame for a chunk of it. But the employment situation, you can't help but ask the question as to whether or not, if the European Union had not grown so fast, had not taken on members whose economy was so vastly different to other members, would such large-scale migration have occurred for economic reasons? And also, as if there had been greater protections for the UK workforce, then would it have been possible for things to have continued without the undercutting? And that, I think, is where the balance is needed between social and commercial. The balance is too far to the commercial side, so that the argument of having the commercial freedom to take workforce at a lower rate makes sense. Whereas if the balance was more even, it would have been more of an ethical decision rather than a pure commercial decision. It's a difficult one. But I do believe that the better social commercial balances from other of the founding EU countries has, I think, to a degree protected them against the kind of commercial exploitation, really, that I think that has happened in this country and that has allowed this situation to happen here. That's not to say that there are far, far other problems that have happened. But I think that key core foundation to the society is better balanced than ours. And I'll probably bring up a few more of those points when it comes to the health side of things. To the ultimate question of will Leave deliver what these people want, what these people need, what our society needs? I don't think it will. To go through the various people in turn, the first person who lost his job because of being undercut. That's going to come down to the deal that is made. As I said earlier, if Britain decides to send those migrants back to their home countries, then the EU is likely to retaliate. And if I can find it, there was an article which basically put the percentage of each country's population that has emigrated to other EU countries, and Britain was pretty much the highest by a little bit of a margin, but yeah, the UK was the highest on that one. 4.9 million, I think, of people who would be have resettled elsewhere in the EU would have to come back. I don't think the government have got the guts to make that call. I think that the government will take the easy option, which is to say, okay, those that have already settled here can stay here. Which, of course, for the people who have been undercut, it won't change their circumstance. It won't deliver anything. For the second person, who sees the new wave of migrants not integrating, will Leave deliver anything on that score? Time will tell, because I think that there will be two batches of people, those that return to where they came from, to the country from which they migrated to the UK, and those that stay. And the question really is then, for those who stay, do they try and make their own communities, of which there are already quite a few, or do they meld into the UK just as the previous migrants had done? Interesting one. The third person who was facing the extreme bout of bad luck, but facing the shortage of investment in society, that I think is down to corporations not paying their fair share of tax rather than immigration. Immigration is placing a larger demand, but the ultimate massive balance of tax is from the multinational corporations. That's something that Brexit will not deliver. Government has to take other steps in order to deliver that and get the money from those multinational corporations in order to reinvest in our society. And to a degree, we have a portion of the blame to carry on our shoulders for that, because that's where we're shopping. We are shopping with these multinationals while also complaining about them and their behaviour. To the businessman and the red tape issue, I think that the issues that the EU has led on, Britain is following. The issue of recycling and getting those figures for packaging and all the rest of it are coming. They will be coming from the UK government eventually, due to the pollution recycling debate, because we are only a few years behind the rest of Europe, but we are on that track. So those questions are only delayed by a matter of about a decade or so, but they're coming. Again, to the people in the pub, I'm skipping the Remainers, but to the people in the pubs who again quoted access to resource, same thing. It's down to social investment, and that's down to money, that's down to tax, that's down to the corporations in my book. And the last, the closing shops. That's down to a change of society, a change of a balance of life, and how and when we want things, and we'll get them delivered to our door rather than go into a high street and use the shops. I don't think that Brexit will deliver what these people hope for and what our society needs. I think ultimately we need a change of political direction to try and work towards this combination of socialism and consumerism, industrialism. You know, we've got to create a merge. Too far one direction or the other fails. Doesn't work. History's proven that one. So we're going to need a change of political will in this country. The problem is, I don't think we've got any party that can deliver it at the moment. And also we need the corporates to pay their way and to be an ethical part of our societies, which at the moment they're not. We have the greed of the bottom line. That is commercialism. That's my view. Hit me up in the hoo-ha bar. You know where the comment button is. At the end of all this, and that foundation of a balance between social and commercial, there was one film. If you wish to invest the time, and however you wish to get a hold of it, is Michael Moore's latest film, Where to Invade Next. Now, yeah, I know, Moore has his own political agenda, as does everyone who is commenting and taking part in the political arena, for want of a better word. But there was a few key parts. Now, in this film, he went around various countries stealing their best ideas to rebuild a new social-leaning US. Obviously, for the sake of the film itself, he just focused on those ideas and ignored the various problems that each of these countries are facing. But as it turned out, a lot of those countries had actually taken those ideas from the US in the first place, and that I think was a good chunk of his message, in that the US started on this bold way forward, and it's been hijacked by the commercial enterprise that's basically used mass media to reprogrammed the population to be scared of anything that's social, along the lines that it ultimately leads to socialism, rather than a healthy balance. The old reds under the bed sort of philosophy. But there was a few things. At the end, near the end of the film, he's in Iceland and interviewing someone, and he asks them, if you were to talk to Americans, if you had 2 minutes to say anything you wanted to the American people, what would you say? And don't be afraid of hurting our feelings. We need some truth here. And the interviewee said the following. I wouldn't want to live in the States, even though you paid me, because there's a society, and the way you treat people, the way that you treat your neighbours, I would never want to be your neighbour, never ever, because you don't treat your fellow Americans the way you should. You, how can you, in a way, come home and feel well if you know that there are so many people that can't eat, they are sick, they can't go to the doctors, they can't get any education. How can you come home and feel okay with that? I couldn't. That pretty much touched me. And I think I'll come back to that in a second. But one of the other things is he missed the UK in that film. In Where to Invade Next, Oscar winner Michael Moore tours a variety of mostly European nations to hold them up as international examples for the US, but notably excludes all of the UK. The omission was intentional. The UK has in recent years started to look much like us, he said at a press conference for the documentary at the New York Film Festival, where the film had its US premiere on Friday. He continued, the UK charges tuition, not as much as we do, but they changed their value system to believing in a system of inequality, especially when it comes to income. And so I wanted to go to places that we could learn from, and I don't think we have much to learn from the UK right now. I'm sorry to say that. At least in England they have started to act like us, think like us and look like us. Our fast food is everywhere. Their kids are now looking like our kids. Despite his harsh words for the UK, Moore was quick to note that none of the countries he profiles in the film are by any means perfect. As I said in the film, I wanted to pick the flowers and not the weeds. Addressing a Finnish journalist in the audience, Moore said, your country has a lot of problems. Germans, French, Italians, every country has a lot of problems. I didn't go there to make a film about your country. My film is about us, not you. I just decided to tell the story about America without shooting a single frame of the movie in the United States. And back to this Icelandic interviewee. The US does have a hope in order to redress that balance away from the commercial element and hopefully move towards that middle element once more. It had that opportunity at the last election, and I think pretty much blew it in terms of Bernie Sanders, however you want to call him as a result of that. Instead of going that way, the fear of the socialism aspect kept the Democrats from putting Sanders forward and instead went with Clinton, who ultimately pretty much was rejected because of the commercialism aspect and her links with the big corporates who have pretty much done so much damage over the last few decades towards repressing the workforce and the inequality issue. So the battle was between her and Trump instead of between Sanders and Trump. But there will be, the 4 years are ticking. so long as Sanders stays around, there may be another chance for America. In Britain, that situation is a lot more complex. At the moment, we don't have a Bernie Sanders. Labour is in disarray. The Lib Dems have taken a beating, and it's going to be quite some time for them to regain the public trust. And the Greens and their record in Brighton, woohoo, yeah. We don't have, at the moment, a reasonable political challenger to the Conservatives. We're just going to have to hold on for the next few years and see what comes, see what happens. It's going to be a nasty road. But, yeah. I think that last link that I will put in there is to that Guardian article on more the UK and the problems and yeah. Where am I going to put this? I'm going to put it there. On its own, The Guardian. I have completely forgotten what other links I was actually looking for. I dare say that at some point I will manage to find them and put them up. But for now I'm just going to process this and get it up there and actually hit bed. Because this whole thing is exhausting. It's more complicated and far-reaching and so much more in-depth than anybody can possibly hope to convey during even a few hours worth of YouTube video, for crying out loud. And on top of that, there's just so much depth and so many interlinking issues. My head is spinning, and only part of that is down to the alcohol. Brexit is happening, and we are going to have to put our shoulders against the wheel. But Brexit will not solve the problems that we are facing. A degree of that is going to be in the Conservatives' hands as they negotiate the Brexit process, for sure. But given their alignment to corporates rather than people, I don't think that the concerns of the people who voted for Brexit are going to be met by this government's negotiation for Brexit. And as the closing of the Panorama programme asked, who are they going to hold responsible? Who are they going to blame? Britain is in for a very interesting few years. Bye for now.